You'd also mentioned side saddle.
Yes.
Where on earth did that come from?
Well, side saddle is the result of false beliefs. For ages, it was believed that women should not ride, and if they had to, for reasons of transportation, they have to sit in a side saddle and not astride to protect their reproductive organs, and they were not to be astride on a horse that bounces and traumatizes a rider who cannot sit correctly. When you sit correctly, you blend your body into the horse's movement. It's not just sitting adhesively and not wobbling loosely or bouncing, but literally integrating your physique with an unmoving horse's physique.
But that was the only reason.
It was, and this was, yes, and to protect a woman.
Well, it seems like the man would need more protection. Yes, the man has more cause to ride side saddle than the woman.
No, one can say that. One could say that. But men were to train the horses and use both legs. Well, women used on the off side, on the right side, the whip. And on the left side, they had the one leg and the spur. But men were thought to be completely safe if they sat correctly. We are not supposed to sit in the crotch. We had to sit on the seat bones. So the pelvic region of contact is triangular. And you have to imagine a speedboat on a lake, and the front of the boat is rising out of the water, and where the motor is sunken in, pushing the boat forward. The pelvis of a man is to operate like that. You raise the front of the pelvis up, it leaves the saddle, and the two seat bones and the rounding of the lumbar back, not the hollowing of the lumbar back, propels the pelvis like a boat effortlessly on the wave and surfs it. It's surfing the lumbar region, surfing over the wave of the horse's movement. And if a rider is not taught correctly and coached to sit correctly, there will be trauma. And some of the riders have lifelong, and you could ask the horse, hey fellow, how does that feel when this, you know, with this cement breaker bouncing on you, you know, tenderizing your meat. And the horse would tell you about terrific lumbar pains and stuff, you know. But we don't ask the horses. We just admire the rider who is up there in a beautifully cut coat bouncing. So then, nobody thought that men can suffer any particular problem or damage by sitting correctly on a horse. And women were protected by the design of the side saddle. But very few women were taught or allowed or expected to ride because they were conveyed in carriages and in shorter distances in litters. That's not garbage, but litter being the the comfortable armchair carried by four muscle men from Santa Monica Beach. So, litter is carried by humans. Ancient Greek muscle men or medieval muscle men, but somebody carried the women in those days. And they were not to ride astride. It started in the 20th century, really beginning of 20th century. And it took hold more precisely really after World War I, when women were very much liberated. I mean, their clothing completely changed, legs were visible. I mean, my grandfather would tell stories how they were, you know, it was a whole day's program for them when they were teenagers to see a woman's ankle, and they were following them around and trying to bump with walking canes to somehow lift the skirt for a split second so the ankle would show and they would, oh, and they would have the day just solved the whole problem. Well, all of a sudden after World War I, you could see the lady's legs and the figure was not distorted by corsets or cushions or something, but they had the natural female figure and silhouette, completely modernized within moments, so to speak. And then, yes, they put on the breeches and the riding boots and rode horses astride like men and became very good at it, obviously. But it's very interesting because it's a very sudden break with a 2,000-year tradition. Women didn't ride in the ancient times either. It was unheard of.
Was there a Susan B. Anthony of the side saddle movement?
Not that I know of, no. Side saddle, yes, like even the Empress Maria Theresa, who was so famous, she was a very significant ruler. So was Catherine the Great of Russia, talking about woman's liberation. Men cowered in front of them already at the end of the room when they entered. But Maria Theresa ruled 40 years from 1740 to 1780. And she established the Pragmatica Sanctio, which was that women can inherit the throne, because there was first only male could inherit in the Habsburg dynasty, and she changed that. She took her son to the Hungarian parliament in Bratislava, which was then called Pozsony, and held him up. That man became Joseph II, the emperor, but she held him up and said, "Would you gentlemen deny the throne to your future king?" And this was the little boy, because if she couldn't be empress, that boy would never be emperor. The inheritance would switch to a side, some cousins, not a direct inheritance. And she challenged the nobles and said, "You have to give me a new law that women can inherit and I be crowned." And they did. They made the new law, they crowned her, the Empress of Austria. She was terrific. She ruled very great. She elevated the empire and all the people in it. It's the same with Catherine the Great of Russia.
Victoria.
And Queen Victoria. They were outstanding rulers. They made that lasted for hundreds of years.
Did they all ride side saddle, or did one of the...
No, side saddle. Yeah, well, I don't... I think Queen Victoria also rode, but I don't remember seeing a picture of her on horseback. But if she rode, it was side saddle. But I think she rode, because it's written somewhere that she went out hunting with this retainer she had, this Scottish man. And there's a lot of literature about her hunting, so she must have ridden. She must have been a good enough horsewoman, I don't know. But I know that the Empress Elizabeth was famous for her horsemanship. So there were good ones. What else did you ask about these... I don't know how I got to these empresses.
The side saddle,
and I already ended up, yes, with them ruling. But it's important to know, I think.